Our next speaker is Valerie Brader. And for those who are active in the energy discussion in Michigan, Valerie is certainly somebody who needs no introduction, but I'm going to give her one anyway. She is the Deputy Legal Counsel and Senior Policy Advisor to Governor Rick Snyder. Her service with the administration started in 2012, so she's been at this a while, serving as the Chief Energy Policy Officer at the MEDC. Next month, Ms. Brader is expected to begin her new role as Executive Director of the Michigan Agency for Energy. She's fantastic and is somebody who not only comes at this with a huge amount of knowledge, but also a real passion for figuring out the right way forward and really sort of embodying the spirit of a no-regrets energy policy. Valerie Brader.
Good morning. Thanks for having me. You know, we're a pretty weird administration, as people know. Governor Snyder gets really excited about talking about things like reducing energy waste and combined heat and power being a great opportunity for that in the industrial sector. So you may have a lot of folks who think, oh, yeah, it's a nice thing. We're really excited to have so many people talking about combined heat and power facilities because we really see them as an obvious place for Michigan to take advantage of some of our resources. You know, we're a big industrial state, and we really see the benefits of combined heat and power at those facilities. You know, when we were looking at what is the right thing to replace the coal plant that's closing in the Upper Peninsula, a lot of which is really serving Cliffs, when you sat down and did the economics, a combined heat and power plant closer to Cliffs made all the sense in the world. And that's something that they're working on designing now. But it was just one example of what we've seen. The state itself has taken advantage of this at our secondary complex. We put in a combined heat and power system there, and we're not only seeing real energy savings and obviously the other benefits that come from that, but it helps us in our resilience, in our disaster planning. So when you look across the country and you say, what are some of the values of combined heat and power? You know that it has the ability to help critical facilities keep operating in times where there's electric disruptions. And so some of our key facilities for the state now have that combined heat and power system helping to back them up. You know, other states saw Hurricane Katrina, Hurricane Sandy, some of the real help that combined heat and power facilities had in giving that resilience and that disaster response. So there's a lot that you see when you look at a combined heat and power facility that the benefits to the industry or the office buildings and complexes that attach to that. We see the resilience benefits of the grid. You see the affordability benefits and, of course, the environmental benefits of taking what would normally be a waste product, that heat, and putting it to use. So as I think many people in this room, because I see a lot of familiar faces, know, when the governor thinks about energy, thinks about having three pillars sitting on that foundation of adaptability, those three pillars being affordability, reliability, and protection of the environment. And CHP can often be a winner on all three of those pillars. And then going to that adaptability, trying to make sure that we have as many different types of diversity of energy so that we haven't put all of our eggs in any one basket, that we have the ability to help energy-intensive businesses choose Michigan to grow and compete. Certainly where you've got CHP there, that can be a big bonus for that competition because, again, all that waste heat can go and feed into a system and have that advantage. And, you know, as said with the state, it isn't just industrial processes. Where the state had a whole set of state buildings, a lot of which are office complexes, having that combined heat and power system really let us take advantage of all the free cooling one gets during a Michigan winter, for instance, and really bring down our power needs there. And so this, while it's something that is an obvious pair with industry, you see it on the commercial side, too, especially where you have a campus of buildings. It can make a lot of sense, and we know. And to the extent that there are folks who would like to sort of show someone, hey, this can work for an office complex, to the extent you want the state's numbers, heck, we'll tell you everything because we're the state, right? We'll show you what it cost us to build it, what the savings have been. let you talk to the operators in terms of what they've seen. So if you've got folks who are wondering if that can work and they need an example and they want to really see it, I do want to offer that up because we're pretty proud of what we've got. And to the extent that it can help others, we'd like to be able to share that experience because it's been a winner for the Michigan taxpayers and it's been a win for Michigan citizens broadly beyond just the money savings too. In terms of both our in emergency response and preparedness, which can matter for a lot of office buildings as well. And it's been a win, obviously, on the environmental side for not using what we don't need. So overall, when we think about CHP, it's one of the things that we think has to be considered as part of Michigan's energy future going forward and really looking at all of its benefits in those areas and putting it up against anything else to say, when we're kind of looking at Michigan's overall portfolio and the portfolio of individual utilities and how we reach the demands that we're coming, we need to make sure we're thinking about all those resources and looking at all those resources and balancing all of the attributes they bring. There's no perfect source of power, but if you can get a nice diversity of power, you can get your very best outcome for Michigan and have that no regrets energy policy that the Snyder administration is so focused on. So I wanted, first of all, to thank you all for putting that time in to exploring this, thinking about it. Many of you have already worked on projects, so thank you for already helping to make Michigan more adaptable. And I would be happy to take some questions that folks might have, but I will say going forward, we, from our own experience, know that combined heat and power really can be the right answer, and that it can be the right answer in different sectors. We're interested in understanding what the barriers are and how the state can better value all the aspects that combined heat and power can bring on those pillars, and thinking about when we're planning a full portfolio, how we value that and plan for that as part of our overall needs for capacity, for energy, and for keeping Michigan jobs and Michigan businesses healthy and strong now and in the future. So with that, I'll take a few questions if folks have them. Did they not serve you coffee? Okay, there we go.
I usually don't need these. I'm going to burn a lot more gas. I'm probably going to generate some, excess NOx. So what's the state of Michigan doing to help me and help you understand that I'm taking it away from a coal plant? Yes, I'm generating some on my site, but I'm reducing the total so that I'm not penalized because I'm trying to help out.
So the first thing I'll say is if you are looking at putting in a facility and thinking you need an air permit, please come talk to the folks at the DEQ prior to filing because they will do these pre-permit meetings. They often make the whole experience go more smoothly. And especially on CHP units, those tend to be units we have a lot of experience with, so they can give you some real good guidance. And we've seen the permit times be a lot shorter than they used to be. So I will just note that if you are considering doing that, I strongly encourage you to take advantage of that. The other thing is that the administration has proposed having a revision to our energy law that goes toward looking at our certificate of need process and really expanding it and saying if we have a region-wide or statewide environmental or reliability goal that needs to be met, that everybody's got to participate in, let's have a process where there can be input from the DEQ about what the requirements are, and then the various utilities or other entities that might have to meet that requirement come in and sort of say what their plan is and work up a plan, with the state to say what's the most cost-effective way to meet that. One thing we've seen in the past on rules that, the feds have imposed on us is that cooperation between entities, especially smaller entities, often was able to bring the cost down notably. I mean, I'm thinking of the way that a lot of the municipal utilities cooperated in previous rules regarding SOX and NOx, those acid rain precursors. We want to make sure that those opportunities for cooperation exist for any other regulations that would be coming down, either on the reliability side for not having enough physical plants or on any environmental side, so that DEQ could be giving input on what they know best, which is really the environmental side, and the folks who know our reliability and are affordability issues the best, the Public Service Commission would have the ability to sort of weigh in and together come to our best plan, which could include, hey, look, I'm putting something up over here, but that's letting someone else come down over here, making sure that we have some way to weigh that, because in our current legal and regulatory environment, it's extremely difficult to make that comparison just because of the way that the federal government has structured its laws, and without having sort of a process on the state level to try to fix that. We don't have that today, but something our administration is very interested in having in the future. That's it. They really didn't serve you enough coffee. So I then will get off the stage. Oh, no, wait. Oh, we do have one more? Okay. I missed it. Whoever was waving their hand should stand up. Okay, great.
So this is more of a big picture question, but as an industrial state, Michigan has a lot of things going for it in terms of CHP development, in particular identifiable concentrated thermal loads in lots of places. What are some things you're discussing or could discuss to encourage more engagement between the utilities and all these private entities, rather than, you know, kind of be an adversarial situation or kind of oblivious to one another? You know, that there's a real opportunity to, if we could unlock or connect, you know, those entities in a positive way rather than a negative one.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that the administration's proposal regarding having an expansion of our certificate of need process to really look at the whole portfolio and to value things like energy waste reductions, which obviously CHP would be an element of that, although it's also new generation, to really say we need to look at our whole portfolio and not just have that kind of planning process come into place when there's one enormous plant that gets proposed or an enormous investment at one plant that gets proposed. You know, right now under the law, if I'm a utility and I want to build a new plant that costs $500 million, I can go use the certificate of need process. If I want to make an improvement at four different plants that together total that amount, I can't. That's kind of crazy to me. You know, so what we've been proposing is to say every, you know, certain period of time, it would vary by utility, you got to come in, you got to show us, here's how we're going to meet our needs overall. And that should be put to the standard that we would put a big new plant to in the con process today, which is that it's got to be the most reasonable and prudent alternative. And obviously in our con today, the way that you kind of prove that is to cost test it and say, look, we asked and here are the options. This would really broaden that to say, you know, those smaller investments, because often CHP is not a $500 million project, right? So the ability to say, look, that piece of what you're thinking of doing, we think we could do for less or provide these additional benefits. The other thing that the administration's proposal does is advocate to allow the MPSC to weigh compensation for this to make sure that it's not a lose-lose proposition from the utilities perspective, because we think there are a lot of opportunities for win-win. We're not saying here is the exact formula that should be used, because we think it may vary, you know, depending on where it is, what utility, et cetera, what the proper level of compensation is. But we would encourage the legislature to give the MPSC the ability to look at compensation for energy waste reduction broadly and make sure that that has some value to the utility as well as to the businesses that are enjoying the benefits on their bills. So, you know, that may be a longer answer than what you had hoped for, but I think looking at it, we're really seeing having the utilities show their full portfolio and saying, how do we compare all those aspects and get to the most cost-effective, most reliable solutions is a really important thing. And then looking at it on when you do have a statewide rule, you know, Lord only knows what the EPA is going to do on the carbon rule. Lord only knows if what they do we think will be doable. But there is some opportunity to say, look, if we've got projects that make sense anyway to help our industrial customers get that waste, that thermal load met more economically, and if it's something we ought to be doing anyway because it's cost effective and benefits our customers, and it also counts towards some federal mandate, well, that's all the more reason, you know, we ought to do that, because we're real fans of keeping energy decision making in Michigan as much as we possibly can. And to the extent that we have smart projects that we could do that would keep the feds off our back, we ought to make sure that we're removing the barriers to doing them. Yeah.
One of the areas that I find unlike a lot of energy efficiency programs. You know, whereas there's gas efficiency, there's electric efficiency, but then CHP gets caught in the fuel switching situation where it doesn't qualify any place for any kind of incentives from the utilities. And the East Coast, Connecticut, Massachusetts, a lot of the different states, they're saying, okay, my cost of building a new coal plant is $2,000 a kilowatt. If I help someone with CHP, I can, and give them $500, I can make these economical. And it's much cheaper for the whole utility system to be able to incentivize the CHP and have the your people putting it in carrying part of the cost but not the full cost.
And again, the sort of description of what the administration is advocating for, that essentially expanded planning that is coupled with a certificate of need process and with the MPSC having the authority to approve cost mechanisms that would essentially allow resources that are the right mix to be compensated. I think we're trying to get at that because we understand the difficulties there. That's not to say CHP will always win, just as natural gas will not always win, just as, you know, renewables not always win, but that we're creating a situation where the value that each type of energy brings, including the resiliency value and the other benefits that CHP has outside of the pure power costs, get evaluated so that when you're adding it all up, you know that as a whole, you're going to meet your reliability and your affordability and your environmental mandates all at once in the most effective way possible. And so that's what we're really going for, is how do you put that head-to-head and allow people to say, hey, look, that piece of what you're doing, I could help you with that. I could make that more economical. How do we get there to recognize that a lot of times private parties, it's worth it for them to put some money into it because it'll save them that much. If those other benefits save all the ratepayers all that much, can't we share the cost and get a benefit for both sides? Okay. Thank you very much.